Now, ladies and gentlemen, bringing out and calling out on the stage here, two United States Marines, the Everly Brothers, who've just finished their boot training out on the coast. So let's have a wonderfully warm welcome for them, will you? The Everly Brothers. Glad to have you back on our show.
Thank you very
Congratulations.
Much.
I understand you put on 20 pounds?
That's right.
Wow, well, you look great.
Thank you.
Sing a number there for Colonel Glenn.
Be glad to.
I'll never let you see the way my broken heart is hurting me. I've got my pride and I know how to hide all my sorrow and pain. I'll do my crying in the rain. Raindrop falling from heaven would never wash away my misery. But since we're not together, I pray for stormy weather to hide these tears I hope you'll never see. Someday when my crying's done, I'm gonna wear a smile and walk in the sun. Baby, but till then, darling, you'll never see me complain. I'll do my crying in the rain. I'll do my crying in the rain.
We turned around twice, and then you had to be English. It was in to be English. From England there for a period of time, especially the Beatles and then the Rolling Stones. And a lot of good came over, but then it dominated the airwaves for quite a period.
Did you feel the pressure to change your way of performing?
Well, the only pressure I felt, everyone says, geez, the Beatles sound an awful lot like you. And I said, well, what can I do? From our side of the music business, there all of a sudden became a thing very square. If you didn't get stoned and you didn't have the really long hair and that
and
element
that
about your mystique, you know. And I mean, I was listening to the music, and to me it wasn't revolutionary. I mean, it was louder and more tracks. But they didn't know what to think of us at all, not at all. I mean, even if we didn't wear tuxes, they didn't know what to think of us. They knew that we were from the 50s, you know, and that was not the 60s, you know. It was that attitude, and our songs didn't have anything about any double meanings, really, you know. So we had a hard road to hoe within that group, and we had also worked Vegas, and that was really bad. Music to quit being something you could earn an honest living by. It had to be a social movement.
I always felt that the 60s were phony. Through that psychedelic period, you still have to get records played. And when everybody has an attitude that, they're going for like that sort of political reform and this, that, and the other. I think the 60s was a very bad period for music.
In the 60s, we were never able to break that into that record thing at all, no matter what music we pursued. I got stoned, I did everything, trying to record something. I said, there was something I'm missing in this whole thing. Got a second record stoned, so that didn't work. But we just would never accept it.
Did it get you down, though?
Yeah, well, it got me down a bit. I wanted to be on records. I mean, I found myself all of a sudden, I mean, we were working, but we were making, I think, some really good, we made some really good records.
Way down in Boulder.
kind. They let you think you're a man. The man in Kentucky sure is lucky. In Bowling Green you walk your own line. Like Kentucky sunshine makes a heart unfold.
Don and I toured almost 16 years, and we'd been working for years and years before, so I'd had a lot.
Phil and I, for a while, was working 7-8 months a year, 9 months a year, and so you, that takes it up, takes up the year. And if you do that for a period of 20 years or something like that, you've got a big chunk of your life has been spent traveling, being a duet in the music business, and especially the kind of duet Phil and I are, you know, close harmony and nose to nose right up on stage there every night. If when we were working, that takes a lot of, it's a lot of strain on the relationship.
Bluegrass is fine, Kentucky owns my
The real pressure in that was the business. It's the business. We had more to worry about than that. You mean like sibling rivalry, continuing past adolescence all the way into adulthood? No, it's more the pressures of business. That is a method I think people, a lot of people have tried to handle us with that, because it's a, you know, it's a simplistic kind of view that that's what would be a problem, and that led to the ultimate end of the Everly Brothers, but it's untrue.
Sure. Well, obviously that sort of, it's something that I think everybody would is interested in, the fact that you were so close, and you, when you sing, you're so close. And then what, can you just tell me about the last time you performed together?
Well, I never really basically discussed it. I've basically approached my life this way. Yesterday is yesterday, and if you take all of your past mistakes and drag them into your present, you're only going to confuse your present. Your tomorrow's more important than your yesterday.
I went through a period I didn't want to sing anything that Phil and I had done, but you did. I needed a rest. I wasn't pursuing it. I spent a lot of time just sort of living, I think, an ordinary life, which I hadn't done before. You know, I think that took up a lot of my, I'm sort of amazed, you know, to be off the road for the first time that I could remember. I did one album in California, really out of the sort of the thing of feeling, well, I should do an album, you know, and I did one. And it was a band called Heads, Hands, and Feet coming to town. Albert Lee became a good friend of mine. And I wound up really sort of working with them and on a collaboration of an album called Sunset Towers.
Periodically, I will get an urge to go play, and I would go do it. But I didn't. I'll go 2 years without performing in front of somebody. It would be, and it wouldn't bother me too much, because I would make music at home, and I was always satisfied.
Be sure and put your phone number down. As Don told you, they have a fine program Monday through Friday, 2 o'clock in the afternoon, called Tune Test. And neighbors, if they call you up, you're going to be pleasantly surprised. Donnie, you're not feeling another guitar tune coming on. Let's get in the gear, see and play another old favorite called Stingin' the Blues, huh?
The
Everly Brothers are the all-time greats. They have the two most extraordinary voices in pop and put together.
What I think is incredible is that you know, the early records were 25 years ago and the voices are still just unbelievable.
There's really no better singers than the Everly Brothers, is there? I don't think there's any better singers than them.
The voices, I mean, they've managed to keep their voices, you know, throughout 25 years of rock and roll, and they still sound like, you know, two birds with crystal clear voices. Amazing.
How long have you been an Everly fan?
Oh, I think all my life, as long as I remember, anyway.
Yeah. When did you first hear their stuff?
I guess I started listening to them when I was about 16. I mean, that's as far back as I can remember, and I've always absolutely loved them, so I was really happy to see them back together again.
It's 10 years. Why this year?
That's a good question. I think maybe this could be, I'm tired of everyone saying, why don't you do it? Why don't you do it? Why don't you do it every day of my life? And when we finally decided to do it, people quit asking me that question. And I don't know, the times change, and you change, you mellow, and you see things, and you get anxious again. Maybe I had enough time. We had enough time alone, or, you know, enough time away from the road and everything. But then, sooner or later, time changes. And I don't know. It's an adventure. That's the major thing. Right now, it's an adventure again, which is wonderful.
If your father were alive, he'd love to see this.
He would be there with us.
Yeah.
That's the one regret.
I also, too, think that I kind of feel, because we're playing the Royal Albert, that Dad is there. And it's special, you know, because I know that he really, no matter what, all of this other stuff, that Dad basically would like this. This is important. And it's more important that we do this, regardless what we do afterwards and all of that. It's important that we sing together at least once more. And it's a magic moment in my life, you know, and Don's too, so it was just ideal.